Present.
Ms. Barbara Whitley.
Present.
Ms. Linda Chaney.
Present.
Dr. Kelly Joseph.
Here.
Ms. Amy Holland.
Here.
Dr. Candace Robertson.
Present.
Ms. Tracy Womack.
We have first item, receive 2015-16 fiscal year audit report, Bruno Turbulon, LLC.
Mr. Larry Jones from Bruno Turbulon will present.
Okay, once again, my name is Larry Jones. I'm the director with Bruno and Turbulon. We have performed the audit of St. Helena as of June 30th, 2016. We have three reports in front of you, the audited financial statements. That's the 85-page report. We have the agreed upon procedures. That's the data from the state that's required, and the federal grants report. I'd like to go over the annual audited financial statements first, give a brief presentation. It's a fairly large report. Kind of highlight the totals. Page two, we have our opinion. And we're giving an opinion on the financial statements. You have several opinion units. The fund statements, the government-wide statements, and your other financial statements, other funds at least. And our opinion on those financial statements is an unmodified opinion. That's the best type of an opinion you can receive. There's no higher. And basically, it's saying that your financial statements are fairly stated in all material respects. Beginning on page five, you have a management discussion and analysis section. That's basically an overview and an analysis of your financial activities for the year. Page eight and page nine, you have condensed financial statements. This is prepared by management. So page 12, we begin the statements, the statement of net position. This is your government-wide financials. In these statements, you have long-term liabilities recorded as well as capital assets. In your fund statements, which we'll go over a little bit later, those do not have capital assets and long-term liabilities. It's strictly on a current basis. That's the fund statements is what you used to budget your finances, but here the government-wide statements is pretty much like for-profit statements. It has everything in it: depreciation, capital assets, long-term debt. Fund statements don't. So on page 12, you have your statement of net position. It's pretty. It's like a balance sheet, commonly referred to as the statement of net position. Assets, liabilities, and net position. Net position is the difference between assets and liabilities. It's equity. Your total assets and deferred outflows is 21.6 million. Your liabilities and deferred inflows is 26.4. So you have a deficiency there. You have more liabilities than assets. And the reason being is you're required to record your net pension liability. That's a gigantic amount. And that amount for the year was $12 million. Last year was the first time that it was required, so you had to make an adjustment last year to get it in. So you can see $12 million added to your liabilities would cause a deficit, and this is pretty normal with most of your governmental agencies because it's required to be recorded. So once again, your net position is $4.7 million in a deficit. On the next page is a statement of activities. 13 and 14 is a statement of activities. Revenue and expenses presented. On page 13, your revenues in your program revenue section are your grants and your charges for services, which is pretty much your food service. On Page 14, you show your general revenues, which is your taxes, property taxes, sales taxes, things like that, your MFP. That general revenues amount for the year is $12.4 million. Your revenue minus your expenses, you have change in net position, which is a 1.2, is a positive number. That added to your deficit from last year, which stemmed from your pension liability recording. And you have a deficit of 4.7. Now, we did have a restatement of the financial statements in the beginning of the year, which was caused by an error in calculating the calculation of the construction in progress, basically. You had more that should have been recorded as capital construction in progress than that which was last year. So what we do in accounting is to make a prior period adjustment. And that adjustment was about 900 some thousand. We do have a note on it on page 60, note 17. So your net position last year as audited was $7 million. It should have been lower. It should have been $6 million. That correction was due to prior year errors in the calculations related to, you know, the construction in progress, some old buildings that were deleted that shouldn't. So the net amount was $963,000. That lowered your deficiency that was reported last year to the correct amount of $6 million. So it's restated. Going back to page 14, you see where the restatement of $6 million is shown. It has the same amount that's in note 17. Starting on page 15 is your fund statements. This is your general fund, your special revenue funds, your capital projects. These are major funds that are required to be reported in your basic financial statements. Now, your other non-major funds, these are your small amounts in which they are all grouped in one category called non-major governmental funds. So these columns are your required major funds to be presented on your fund statements. Your total assets in total, 7.2 million on page 16, the total column. Your liabilities is 3.2, and you can see in this statement you don't have capital assets, so you don't have your buildings and construction in progress. It's just your short-term assets, cash, receivables, interfund receivables. Liabilities are the same thing. You don't have your long-term liabilities, such as your debt. It's just payables, salaries payables, and you had a short-term note payable here, 1.9 million, which is short-term. Thus, it goes into the fund financial statements. Those liabilities, 3.2 million, subtracting the liabilities from the assets, you have an equity amount, an excess of 3.9, almost $4 million. And you can see how on page 14 you have several categories of fund balance that's required. And it totals to 3.9 million. Page 17 is a reconciliation of your governmental wide statements with the fund statements. There's differences. So it's shown here what those differences are. Capital assets, long-term liabilities, and it reconciles to the different equities. Page 18, 19, 20, and 21, It's a statement of revenues, expenditures, and changes in fund balance. Once again, fund statements, revenues, and expenditures are shown by major funds. And here, your total revenue is $14.6 million. Same thing, you have your local sources, state sources, and federal sources. Then you have your expenditures by function, instruction, pupil, instructional staff, and so on. The total expenses is 21 on page 21. And the total column is $14.8 million. That's subtracted from your revenue. You have a change or excess of deficiency here of $243,000. You had some operating transfers in and out, and some, some transfers to the state, which increased your change in fund balance to a negative amount of $536,000. That's subtracted from your beginning equity balance, which is called fund balance here, of 4.99. Your fund balance at June 30th, 2016, fund financial statements is 3.9. Page 22, you have your reconciliation of your government-wide revenue and expenses to your fund financial statement, revenue and expenses, or the change thereof. On page 23 is your fiduciary net assets. These are your agency funds, your student activities, and your payroll agency funds. And this is just asset and liabilities, because it's not, you don't earn revenues here. You just, this is another fund's activity. So it's just assets and liabilities, no equity. Page 25 begins the notes to the financial statements. They're pretty similar and consistent with prior year reporting. There's an extensive note on your pensions, which is required. I mean, it goes on for about four or five pages. All of it's required to be disclosed in the notes to the financial statements, and that begins on page 36. You have the teacher's retirement system, you have the Louisiana teachers, and you have the state retirement system. All three of those need to be disclosed. And it goes from page 36 through uh, 55, so it's quite a bit of pages of notes dealing with your pension liability, and other information. Page 55, you have a post-employment benefit. That also is disclosed here. Page 58, you have your summary of your long-term obligations. This is your long-term debt, the general obligation bonds. You have two of those. You have a sales tax bond, and it shows what the pension liability started off with and ended with. In between is the additions and the deletions. So basically, that's conclusion of the note presentation. You have supplementary information that's required starting on schedule one. This is your budget comparison. Your general fund needs to be compared, and you didn't have any variances in your budget, general fund budget, your revenues and expenses, actual to budget. Didn't have any state violations there. Also, the Title I budget, you didn't have any violations with the state budget law there on page 63. Schedule 3 is required, you know, note disclosure on your pension information. Note 3 and 4 is a pension information requirement. And Schedule 5 is just your showing of your other nine major funds, all of your nine major funds grouped together in total. That's the balance sheet and the statement of revenue and expenses and changes in fund balance. Those two schedules are presented. Now, the total of these two schedules are moved to the basic financial statements in the front of the report. So basically, that's a summary of the highlights of the audit report. What's important, you do have an unmodified opinion. That's the best opinion you can receive, so that's pretty good. Now, your other two reports, the next one, I believe, is the federal grants. And this report has two reports within it, one dealing with government accounting auditing standards, and one is dealing with the unified guidance, which is your federal funding requirements. You didn't have any findings dealing with your federal funds. However, you did have one finding, and it dealt with the restatement of your financial statements, because you're not supposed to have a material misstatement in your statements, and you did have one. So with the corrective action, and that's on page 13, called prior period adjustment. So you should have internal controls that should be adequate enough to catch any material misstatements that may be reported. So you should have something designed to catch it, and what the corrective action is from management is they will implement a timeline in which in the closing process, they will do more reviewing and approving the information that needs to be adjusted to the unadjusted financial statements, to look at any adjusting entry that needs to be made, and more so any material adjustment that needs to be made. They will pay more closer attention to that adjustment and have it documented as reviewed and approved. St. Helena does bring in an external accountant in, and any entry is not only from management, but from this external accountant needs to be reviewed and approved. So that process is going to be put in earlier. It was a later process. Now it's going to be, it'll begin immediately after the statements are closed, June 30th. And anything that needs to be added to those statements need to be closely monitored. So that's a good thing to have the closing process early and with a lot of review. So that's the only finding. The actual reporting to the state, it was considered to be timely because you had an extension that did not require the finding for witness. So that was good. And the last report is the agreed upon procedure. That's dealing with student data and I guess employee data. Employee data. This report showed, we did not have any findings that were required to be reported. That report starts on page 2. At least the reporting of the required procedures that needed to be done. We did all of the procedures noted on page 2 through 5. And those detailed procedures, we did not have any differences noted, so there was no findings that needed to be reported. So I will say that coming June 30th, 2017, the state is requiring different sets of agreed-upon procedures, and it deals with a lot of information, from traveling and entertainment, credit card use, minutes, policies, and Amy did give each board. So I gave each board member the required agreed-upon procedures. It's pretty extensive, and it's going to be added along with the other agreed-upon procedures. So it's one more thing that needs to be done for everybody, all of the state agencies. So that's pretty much it. If you have any questions, I'm available at my office to receive any questions you may have, explanations, comments. Everything went well. All of the documentation and cooperation was good. And I thank Dr. Joseph for the staff providing all of the information that was necessary for us to complete the audit.
So the only really material witness, the only really material witness was this prior period adjustment.
Yeah,
that was it.
That was it.
And that was due to.
It was a calculation formula error, so it so it got by us.
We corrected that.
Right.
I do have a quick question.
Okay.
The post-employment benefit obligation that we have to put on the books.
That's, yeah.
Right, and then there's really no guarantee that that's the actual amount, but it's just.
No, you have an actuarial determination each year, and we pretty much use those numbers to either add or subtract from the liability. You have a professional who comes in and looks at all of the information dealing with lifespans and how long you're going to be paying this benefit.
It's a future liability.
This is a future liability.
That they want us to put on the books.
Right, and that's the same thing with the net pension liability is your future. In the past, we just recorded what you paid this year in contributions.
Right, instead of putting the whole thing.
Right, the whole thing. So this
is
saying.
So how's that going to impact us when we do the projections for USDA?
It's a fund basis, it's on a fund basis. So your net pension liability is not included. So that's good. Thank you.
So we'd like to thank you, North Turbalon, again. They come out every year and do this audit, and very professional, and does everything by the book. So we want to thank Mr. Jones for coming out and presenting the findings to us.
Thank you.
I think you have in your package the 2017-18 salary schedule. The salary schedules themselves did not change. The only changes we made were the number of days in the year was adjusted, and also the holiday on page 27 were adjusted, but no salary schedules were changed.
You said none of them were changed? Same as last year. Any motion? Moved by Ms. Chaney.
My second.
Second by Ms. Withers. Oh.
Dr. Hurst?
Yes.
Ms. Chaney?
Yes.
Ms. Withers?
Yes.
3-0 motion carried. Refer to the full board.
Item 5. Next item. Receive proposed 2017-18 annual operating budget.
Okay. This is just to be received and advertised, and it'll be approved in the April meeting. So it's I'm giving it to you to look over for a couple of weeks, but I will hit some highlights in it. On the first page is the general fund budget summary by function, and this just lists the different categories that we have to report. If you look at the total revenues, it's $8.7 million. And if you look at the revenues, the first column is we have to estimate through the end of this year, which is basically our budget. And then we project for next year. They use the same MFP, the same revenues that we have right now. We'll have an adjustment this month. And when I find out what it is, when we come back in the April meeting, I'll adjust that MFP number up to what, because they told us what it is, but we don't know how to adjust it because of the session. That'll be an adjustment that I will make. Coming down in the expenditures, you'll notice that the regular programs, I'm budgeting $3.4 million instead of 3.1. The difference there is I'm budgeting certified full-time teachers for next year for all the positions that we have right now. Same thing, special education.
I'm sorry, Amy, where are you?
First page.
Okay.
I'm sorry. And basically the other ones, there's not a whole lot of variances in those. Student transportation, it went up significantly this year and may go up a little bit next year, but we'll know more about that if the routes are adjusted this year. So the total projected expenditures are $8.7 million. Then you have your other sources of funds, the $100,000, that's indirect costs that we get from federal grants. And other uses of funds is transfers we have to make to the state. So the net change in fund balance projected for next year is $63,821. So we're projecting a excess for the coming year in general fund.
So you said fund balance for the next, repeat that?
Our change in fund balance will go up by $63 million. $63,000, I'm sorry. We'll add that to the prior year fund balance of 2.7. And we'll end with about 2.7. These fund balance figures may be adjusted a little bit from the financial statements, but I'll reflect that in April. So that, and behind it, there is the detail. If you want to look at it, if you have any questions about it, just let me know. If you turn to the blue tab, our special revenue funds, and basically those are our grants, IDEA, preschool, child nutrition, sales tax, and the total was $4.4 million. And basically most of these are just reimbursement type grants except for sales tax and the 16.4 mils, that's the millage that the employees get extra. And the yellow tab is the capital projects. The only one that's in here is the maintenance, 5 mil and 10 mil. The bond and other ones will be in the April to be approved. Are there any questions?
So financially, we are stable.
Okay. And this, like I said, when I get the final MFP for this year, it may be better than this. I didn't want to do it until I knew for sure.
And what's the amount
that we're going to get? It's right now it's $8,476,000, but I anticipate that it's going to go up. But because of the session, I would wait to see. But I will adjust it and I will point that out at the April meeting.
And that's general fund.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason I ask, it seems that we're doing quite well and we're stable. And I've had some kids come to me and say, "Ms. Hurst, buy some donuts, buy this, buy that." And I'm like, "What is it for?" And they tell me, "Well, it's for playground equipment at our school." With me knowing how expensive playground equipment can be, they're going to have to sell a whole lot of donuts to get there. And at the rate, considering the area we're in, it could take a long time to do that. So I just want to ask the board to consider allowing the superintendent to see the prices of playground equipment for the early learning center at least, and possibly the board approving to get that equipment for those students.
We've already started that process when we moved the kids over to the early learning center, so we have that already down. The issue that I have, and I want to caution the board, while we are stable and we're in a really good financial situation, you do know that the state is cutting a lot of funding out of education and a lot of other areas. So we have to be very mindful about how we spend our dollars. We need to really have a good, I guess, nest egg in the event something happens so we can absorb the blow. If you looked in the report from Bruno and Turbulon, it shows you how every year we are required to pay more in retirement benefits and all kind of other benefits for our employees. And there are a lot of funds that are taken away from us for other things that the State Department is pulling. So we have to be very, very careful about, you know, the amount of monies that we do spend. But I agree, we do need to upgrade our playground equipment. And so we will look at matching funds for the Early Learning Center. You know, whatever they, you know, come up with, they may have more than what is actually necessary, or we may be able to match them and get something better than what they anticipated. We also need playground equipment at the Arts and Technology Academy. We absolutely need that. So I agree, we do need to do those things. We just need to be very careful about how we spend those additional dollars. I'm very particular when it comes down to the general fund. And if there are other ways that we can look at maybe grants to get those that playground equipment or any other things that we need, we're also going to look at those efforts.
I did want to point out on the 16.4 meals, the millages that where the employees get an extra amount, the proposition that was passed. We've been able up until this point to fund that, but if we get all certified teachers and everybody gets it, it's going to be, we may not be able to fund that totally by the millage. So that's something we're going to have to look at this year. Thus far, we've not had, all our teachers have not been certified, so they don't get it, but when and if they do, we could potentially not be able to fund it at the rate that we are right now.
And then that happens, what's next?
We dip it in the general fund.
We would have to subsidize it from somewhere else. We could not have that problem up until this point, but potentially it could come up.
I still would like to explore the options, just put them on the table and see what we can.
Sure.
Well, Amy, has there been any increases in the millage based on any income? I know that all gas revenue is down, but has there been any kind of...
It's basically been about the same.
It's been
up a little bit.
I mean, because one of our millages kind of increased about maybe 15% this year.
I can try to, I'll try to have that for y'all at the April and May meeting. I'll show the trend of the last couple of years.
Thank you. That concludes the Budget and Finance Committee.
All right, Personnel Committee is called to order. Roll call. Ms. Virginia Fitt.
Just receiving. Yeah, it has to be advertised in April. You will approve it. Okay.
Ms. Virginia Bell.
Present.
Ms. Linda Chaney.
Present.
Ms. Joyce Porter.
Present.
Dr. Kelly Joseph.
Here.
Ms. Miranda Watts.
Here.
Okay, first item is to receive the personnel updates.
Any number one members? This month's report, we had one new hire at the high school in the PE. We had two resignations that took place, one at the high school, one at the ELC, and we also had two terminations on two employees at charter as well as the ELC. I did get a recommendation in for a new hire for the ELC, so we are in the process of processing that new hire person, and that will be reported on next month's report. As of always, we're continuing to advertise for these vacant positions to make sure our kids have a quality education. Are there any questions?
Okay, thank you. Mr. Alton Travis?
Here.
Ms. Joyce Porter?
Ms. Reed, I'm abstaining from this policy committee. We need to appoint.
Can I appoint Mr. Hurst?
Yes.
Dr. Hurst?
Ms. Linda Chaney?
Present.
Dr. Byron Hurst?
Present.
Dr. Kelly Joseph?
Here.
Lee Ashton?
First item is discuss provisions of the MOU between the school board and Southeast Community Health Center.
drug screening and physicals?
So we do drug screening and physicals for our bus drivers, cooks, our janitors, everyone other than, I believe, the teachers. And this year, I requested that the MOU state that employees of the school board that are affiliated with Southeast Community Health Systems not have their drug screenings done at their site, but somewhere else. And I received information back from Southeast stating that they are not in agreement with adding that to the MOU. So I forwarded the information to our board attorney for his recommendation, and I'll turn it over to him.
Good evening, board members and community. The MOU between the school board and the Southeast Community Health Systems is up for renewal, as Dr. Joseph indicated. And essentially, the one provision that is being recommended on behalf of the board is to insert a provision that would, in an abundance of caution and to avoid any conflict of interest, it would be a provision that would recommend that any employee of the school district who is affiliated with Southeast simply have his or her screening performed at another facility. As a practical matter, the relationship between the board and Southeast, the board is in fact a customer of Southeast, and it is paying Southeast for the services that Southeast is providing. And in terms of the recommendation itself, there's no prejudice to Southeast in making that recommendation, arguably other than some loss of revenue. But in terms of the relationship that does exist with some parties right now, it is my recommendation that the board approves this provision to be inserted into the MOU. And I believe you all had a chance, or you all are familiar with the MOU itself, and it basically outlines the roles and responsibilities of both parties. So.
And this item just says discussed. Do you want us to vote on that?
I'm sorry.
Do we need to vote on this? The item says discuss provisions.
Right. I mean, it would essentially strengthen the superintendent's position in terms of having that provision in there. If the board would take a position relative to that provision being inserted into the MOU. The other option, of course, is to not take any action, but to go back and to present that issue to Southeast and to see what Southeast's response would be. And of course, the board would have the discretion to utilize Southeast's services, certainly explore other options that the board would have.
Anyone from Southeast here?
No. It's my understanding that Southeast had planned on sending a representative here tonight, but they indicated that they were not able to send one.
Committee, like to make any kind of motion on that?
Yes, I say move. I so move.
That we accept these changes?
Yeah.
This change in that moment?
I second.
Been moved by Ms. Cheney and second by Dr. Hurst that we accept the change in the MOU. Is there any further question? Vote.
Mr. Travis?
Yes.
Ms. Cheney?
Yes.
Dr. Hurst?
Yes.
3-0, motion carried. Refer to the full board for vote.
The second item is to request to hold the April school board meeting at the high school auditorium to accommodate the crowd who will be in attendance, to recognize the 7-2A district champion coaches and players.
So next month, we would like to recognize our 7-2A district champions. And in order to accommodate the crowd, we would need to go back to the auditorium to have the board meeting. So I'm requesting that we change the venue for next month only,
have it at the auditorium at the College of Career Academy.
I so moved.
I second.
Been moved by Ms. Chaney and second by Dr. Hurst that we move the board meeting to high school auditorium next month. Is there any further discussion? Vote.
Mr. Travis?
Yes.
Ms. Chaney?
Yes.
Dr. Hurst?
Yes.
3-0, motion carried, refer to the full board for vote.
That concludes the policy committee.
I come to thank you, Ms. Nadine, March 2017. The school board meeting, we thank you for the members, school board members, and our superintendent. Lord bless everything that we undertake to do tonight. Let's call you anyway. And we thank you and praise your name. Thank God. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The meeting room will come to order. We are now holding a meeting of the St. Helena Parish School Board. Roll call.
Ms. Joyce Porter.
Present.
Dr. Byron Hurst.
Present.
Ms. Linda Chaney.
Present.
Ms. Barbara Whitley.
Present.
Ms. Virginia Bell.
Present.
Mr. Alton Travis.
Present.
All members present.
Item B, approve minutes and agenda.
I move to approve the minutes and the agenda.
Is that collective, Mr. Travis?
Yes. I second.
Motion by Mr. Travis. Second by Dr. Hurst to approve the agenda collectively. All in favor of the motion say aye to tap together.
Aye.
All opposed say nay to tap together. The ayes have it. The motion carries. Item C, superintendent's report.
Good evening, board. Good evening, community. I just have a few announcements. The first is we want to introduce the new SU Ag area agent, Mr. Burnell Muse. Could you please come forward? We have Ms. Angela Miles. Will you be doing the introductions?
Good evening. My name is Angela Miles, Parish General Manager of Southern Ag Center here in St. Helena. Burnell is no stranger to the community. He's actually from the community, graduated from one of the high schools. I'm not going to call the name and let him do it. But he went to Southern University and majored in agriculture, and his concentration was plant soil science.
Good evening.
Yes, I did graduate from St. Helena High School in 1977. I'm very excited to be back to St. Helena to work after spending 37 years with USDA Natural Resource Conservation Service as a soil scientist project leader. So I know we're running late on time, but I met a lot of people here, and I look forward to working with a lot of you all. My area of specialty will be agricultural and natural resources. Thank you.
Welcome. Next, we'd like to introduce the new LAE representative for St. Helena Parish, Mr. Antonio Kelt. We have Ms. Clark, who is our union president, that will come up and give the formal introduction.
As you know, we always have a representative from LAE that we count on to be our touchstone for them. And we now have a new one, Mr. Antonio Kelt. He's coming to us most recently from Texas.
Good evening. How's everybody doing? Dr. Joseph, I want to thank you for allowing me to meet the board tonight and everybody that's in the room. So my name is Antonio Kelt. I'm actually from the state of Michigan, the cold state of Michigan, where I was born and raised. Started my career in education, teaching 9 through 12 at an adjudicated juvenile facility, where I actually got involved with doing union representation work, which I've been doing for the last 13 years. I actually moved to Houston 9 years ago, where I worked as a union rep. Through the NEA Association that was over there, as well as through Service Employees International Union, and through ASIC, the City of Houston Worker Employees. I recently moved to Baton Rouge around 2 months ago, and I was hired under the Louisiana Association of Educators, so I'm very pleased to be working in the St. Helena Parish. Looking forward to work with you all. You all know that the students are our most precious resources, and the educators, every staff, every faculty, every member here, is our valued resources to be able to provide the education and whatever resources the kids need to be successful in the parish. And that's what we're here. We're here to actually help to assist you in terms of providing professional development. We also have some programs around cultural competency, as well as behavioral management that will help the teachers in the classroom to be successful. So again, I'm looking forward to working with you all, and thank you all so much.
You're welcome. Welcome, Mr. Pelt. We look forward to some nice negotiations with you. I have an item on my report that is not listed on the agenda. I'd like to remind the board that on March 29th, Bessie will have a special meeting to discuss the ESSA plan that the State Department would like to submit to the Federal Education Department. I'm asking, if possible, that you all attend that meeting. I had two meetings with parents, one at 10 o'clock and another at 1 o'clock today, to discuss the current accountability system and what changes will occur beginning next year. They are significant changes, and I believe that I garnered enough support from the parents that were in attendance that said they would come out and be the voice for St. Helena. So I'm asking if you all had the time to come out on March 29th at 1 o'clock at Bessie, the State Department. They will discuss the ESSA plan that they'd like to present. So if you all have the time, please come out. The last thing on my report, I'd like to talk about the bus transportation incident that occurred last month and a discussion that we had with some board members. After going back and doing a review of all of the concerns, I'd like to share this information with the community. First, there was a concern about the bus rosters. And I reported to this board and to the community that there were bus rosters on each bus and that we had a copy of those rosters here at Central Office. That was not true. We did not have bus rosters at that time. To remedy that situation, I instructed all of the secretaries at the schools to utilize JPAMS, collect all of the information from the students, and input that information into that system. And so it took about a week, and we now have JPAM-generated bus rosters. I gave a copy to each one of the bus drivers and also to Ms. Leatris. So we now have those bus rosters. The second thing that was reported to you all is that there were only about 15 students that were impacted by bus transfers, where a student gets on a bus in the morning and then is switched to another bus before making their way to school. That is also false. When I sent out information, requested information from the schools, from the school secretaries, to give me a list of all of the students who are actually impacted by these transfers, one school alone had 15 children. So we have well over 20, between 20 and 30 children who are impacted by bus transfers. The next thing, the bus passenger, who I said was a bus monitor, that was not accurate either. That person was a substitute who worked at one of the schools, and that person rode the bus to and from work because that person did not have transportation. We immediately corrected that problem, notifying that employee must use their own transportation to get to work. And the last thing that I have a concern about is the mileage that the bus drivers are claiming on their mileage sheets. If in fact we see that there are more bus drivers that are transferring students and not accounting properly accounting their miles on their mileage sheets,
I will hold them responsible, and I will collect the monies that they have taken. I sent out this information, and I know you've all seen it in my weekly memo, to all of my staff and also the leadership teams at the schools, and corrected the information that was presented to you all at the last board meeting. When I say that we are wanting to be, or be taken seriously about what we do, I mean that. I believe in transparency. I believe in doing everything above board. I believe in being honest. I also believe in holding people accountable. And so I'm going through the process of doing that. And I don't like having to come before this board and giving you false information. So as superintendent, I do take responsibility for that, because at the end of the day, being the leader of the school system, it is my responsibility to make sure things are handled properly. And it's also my responsibility to make sure that all of the employees who work for the school system handle things properly. So with that said, I also sent a letter out to all of the bus drivers, reminding them about the higher levels of professionalism that I'm expecting from all employees. And I also expect them to be open, honest, and transparent about what they do every day. And so I sent the letter and attached the bus rosters for them. They are given roster sheets to fill out, but they never turn them back in. So I'm asking, well, since we have the information now in JPAM, we can actually just provide that information to them. And we'll be doing that from this point forward. I also let them know that it is legal to transfer students at safe pickup points. And that if a student is transferred, they cannot get off the bus and wait for the other bus to pick them up. Both buses must be there at the same time, where the child will get off one bus and get on to the next one immediately. And that it is done in a safe transfer point. I did let them know that it is illegal and unethical to claim mileage that they did not run. I explained to them the importance of making sure that the transfer points are safe and approved by me. They cannot pick up or do transfer points just because they don't want to go down a gravel road. It has to be a place that is approved. And we also need to make sure that we notify our parents of the children who are impacted by these transfer points. I also notified them that they are not allowed to have any adults on the bus while they are transporting students to and from school. I also reminded them about the types of insurances that they are supposed to have as they are transporting our children, and also about making sure they follow all laws with regard to speeding, stopping at stop signs, and yielding, and all of those other things. And I'm also asking that they look at upgrading their buses. A lot of the buses are old, and while they may still be legal to drive, we also have to consider the safety of our children. And putting them on a comfortable bus where there'll be less issues to and from school. So this is a very serious matter. Once again, I do not like coming before the board and sharing false information, but when I found out that the information was not accurate, I knew that I needed to come back at this board meeting and make those adjustments. So I do apologize for giving you that false information and pledge that that will not happen again. Thank you. Item D, committee reports. Approve the committee report. Can I get a motion?
Madam President, I motion that we approve the committee reports collectively.
I'll second.
Motion by Ms. Bell, second by Ms. Whitley to approve the committee reports collectively. All in favor of the motion? Any questions?
Question. Ms. Cheney, I convoke all the committees except for the policy committee. I abstain from the policy committee.
All right. Yeah.
Okay, I motion that we approve all committee reports except the policy committee.
Okay, motion by Ms. Bell, second by Ms. Whitley to approve all the committee reports except for the policy committee collectively. All in favor of the motion, say aye. Stepped together.
Aye.
All opposed, say nay. Stepped together. Ayes have it. Motion passes. Now back.
I so move we accept the policy committee.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Hurst, second by Mr. Travis to accept the policy committee report. All in favor of the motion, say aye. Stepped together. All opposed, say nay. Stepped together.
Nay. Abstain.
Abstain.
Okay. The ayes have it. The motion passes. Item E, meeting closing. Announcement of next meeting date will be at St. Helena College and Career Academy to honor our 7-2A district champs. That date is
April 13th,
5:45 committee meeting, and 6:00 regular board meeting. And closing comment, board members? Anybody?
Yes, I would just like to share, thank you, Bell was there. On April the 3rd, May, March the 3rd, we had a community-wide meeting in District 4, and we really had a great turnout, just trying to get the churches in the community to help the community, help the children with mentorship, tutoring, just anywhere we could step up and help, you know. We noticed teachers doing their very best, and we trying to just get the students, you know, where they need to be, the at-risk students, those that need tutoring. And we will be having another meeting April the 28th, but that's not accurate. With subject to change, so we just, you know, start meetings that need as much needed in the community.
No, but we did get a list of folks who said they'd be willing to volunteer to work as mentors. So we have church leaders, we have group leaders, we have politicians, so that's good. And they're offering to mentor the students in any way that they can, anything they can do to help. The minister even offered to send people to the schools to help if that's needed. So I'm not sure where they start. So Dr. Joseph, you may want to kind of give us some input, give some input as to who they should start with to get that assistance to the schools.
You should politicians. Warren
put his name on the list.
Yeah, Warren.
Yeah. So we have one politician.
And to piggyback off that, in the second district, we have also started the dialogue to kind of provide the same services to the school. So we're just talking about it now, seeing how we can get it started and get volunteers for that. And Dr. Joseph, I thank you for clarifying the bus situation from the last meeting.
All right.
From what they were in the fifth district, plan to have some meeting, and we're sure that our elected officials will come out and help us.
All right, I would just like to remind the board members to remember March the 29th, the meeting for the accountability of ESA. So that's at 1 o'clock, and I'm asking my fellow board members to join us that day because I will, and I plan on being there. So I'm asking you guys to join in with us. If we have parents going, we definitely need to have board members as well to represent. March 29th, 1 o'clock. Okay? And Dr. Joseph will send us some reminders.
And a whole lot of information.
Okay?
Yes.
All right. That last motion?
So move we adjourn.
Motion by Mr. Hurst. Second by Ms. Porter. No questions? All yays. This meeting adjourned.